Newell and Jerry Garrett's in the pits. Bob Wellborn waves away the field.
Director of the State Planning Office. Published its report on that very same subject and heard three people from the municipalities giving their perspectives on property tax reform, including our own chairman, Jane Amaral. The group consisted of municipal officials, school board members, superintendents, legislators, and town managers. And from the discussion after the evening, there seemed to be a sense of urgency on the part of local officials to do something about the property tax and to relieve its burden on local taxpayers. The task force, the COG task force, which I'm co-chairing, will be devising information to inform local public officials on the impacts of growth on their budgets and on their taxes, inform them about the decreasing state and federal funds coming to help subsidize our local taxes in the months to come. So I'll be filling in later on as the year goes on our activities.
Thank you, Nancy. I think it was a very exciting meeting, and it was really great to have six of the town councilors from Cape Elizabeth attending that meeting.
And our business manager.
And our state legislator and state senator. That's right. We were extremely well represented. Thank you for your report, Nancy. Any other reports this evening? Okay, if not, I have a resolution that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council passed really last month. It honors the foreman of our treatment plant, which has recently been closed. We are now operating our new treatment plant out on Spurwink Road. And tonight, I'd like to read this resolution. And Ken Reserve is here tonight, and ask him to come up at the end of the reading of the resolution. Whereas Kenneth Reserve has faithfully served the town of Cape Elizabeth for 13 years, during which most of this time he has served as sewer foreman, and whereas he has consistently successfully operated two treatment plants with very limited funds, and whereas his record of devotion to the town has been exhibited on numerous occasions, and whereas this week the town has completed a transition to a new treatment plant, now therefore be it resolved that the town council does hereby express our appreciation to Ken Reserve for his dedicated service in operating the Spurwink and Hunts Point treatment plants, and we wish him well as he continues other responsibilities in the Department of Public Works. Dated this ninth day of November, 1987 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Ken?
I
Thank you. Is there anything you'd like to say? Go ahead. If you'd like to step right up.
I'd just like to thank you, and I don't want any of us to forget who taught me what to do. Fred Williams, who's been a great asset to the town, and I think we owe him a lot. I've enjoyed my years here, and I hope to enjoy a few more. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Minutes of the meeting held on November 9, 1987.
Yes, Doug?
I'd just like to point out item 193. I think it was voting on the original motion. I was lacking as abstaining. I'd just like the record to show that I voted against it, for sure. There may have been some confusion in the vote. That's all.
Yes.
Also on that same item, paragraph Q, there should be a reference to current assessed value rather than adjusted current assessed value.
Is that paragraph Q or G?
Q.
It's Q, okay. Are there any other corrections to the minutes? Would someone like to move that the minutes be accepted as amended?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? All right, that motion carries 6-0. We have two public hearings tonight. The first one is on a proposed ban of parking on a certain section of Woodland Road, and I'll ask the town manager to explain that in absence of our ordinance committee chairman, who is not here tonight. Michael?
Several months ago, there was an accident on Woodland Road involving a truck and a vehicle traveling at a very high rate of speed towards Mitchell Road. But while certainly there were many contributing factors to that accident, one thing that was fairly clear was that perhaps it could have been avoided if there wasn't such a poor sight distance in the area with a poor curb, and if cars were not parked on that curb. Subsequently, the chief of police and myself recommended to the ordinance committee that the council consider banning parking on Woodland Road from the first, as you're coming from Mitchell Road, from the first driveway at the end of the Woodland, at the beginning of the Woodland South Apartments to the second driveway of the Woodland South Apartments. The Ordinance Committee considered that proposal and subsequently recommended that there be no parking on either side of Woodland Road, which was also our recommendation, from Mitchell Road to a point 1,000 feet easterly. That would bring it to about the point where the Woodland Apartments complex ends. The Ordinance Committee felt that it was in the interest of public safety to do so, and that there was other available parking within the Woodland Woodland Apartments for the residents of that area.
Thank you, Michael. Is there anyone from the public who would like to speak on this item at this time? Yes, would you please come to the podium and introduce yourself?
My name is Betty Davis. I manage the Woodland South Apartments at 60 Woodland Road, and I very much oppose your no parking recommendation for this area. I think there's no need of it if you enforce the speed limit. Up until 2 weeks ago, there was no speed limit, and there was a great deal of speeding and reckless driving, and as of 2 weeks ago, you did put up two signs at 25 miles an hour at my request, and I thank you very much for doing that, and I think if you enforce this, there is no problem. I have an office in the first building after you leave Mitchell Road onto Woodland, and I have people coming in there to do business every day. Now these people, if they're not familiar with the Woodland South, they don't know that they can go down around back to park. I don't have tenants that park there regularly at all, but I do have a couple elderly ladies that like to stop there and unload their groceries. And this will be a real inconvenience to all of us. And most importantly is our problem in the wintertime of the snow removal. And for 14 years, we have moved the cars out onto the street to clear the parking lot. Now, during a storm, Mr. Cox comes through and he opens the driveways. But after the storm is over, the next day, when the street is well plowed, at noontime is our procedure, the cars are all moved out to the street and the parking lot is cleared. Now, this takes an hour to an hour and a half, and if we weren't able to put them there, I just don't know what we would do with them. And for 14 years, to my knowledge, there has never been an accident or any problems at all as a result of us doing this. And I really hope you will give this very serious consideration. As far as the accident was concerned, my car was one that was parked there. I had just pulled up to meet a cable TV person, and we were had been there about 5 minutes, and we were right outside of the building trying to decide where we were going to put some wiring, and when the accident occurred. And the as I understand from a tenant that was walking down the street near the Cottage Farms apartments, that car was airborne when it came off of the hill. Now, I feel that there's plenty of room, and I know there's plenty of room, for a parked car and two cars to pass because and during the snowstorms, because I'm there myself with my own car doing this, and so I know that. And I hope you will give this serious thought, because it's going to inconvenience all of our tenants, and we have 54 apartments there, plus my office. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from the public that would like to speak? Yes.
My name is Bob Westberg. I'm a tenant at the Woodland Apartments. And I come here and I'm thinking that there was some compromise to what you had proposed and what the apartment complex wanted us as tenants to come and support. And that was what the town manager, Mr. McGovern, suggested, was that corner could be a dangerous spot, at the 1,000-foot mark or from the first driveway to the second driveway, maybe solve the problems that you see as well as we see as tenants. The snow removal will be a problem. I have no idea where we will put our cars should it snow. I think you should give it some consideration for what we as tenants would have to go through should you put a no banning there. I drive my kids through there all the time. As I say, that corner could be a problem, that no banning parking for that space only, coming around that corner where that accident happened, may be a good compromise.
Would that allow enough parking during plowing time?
Well, I think they can come up with some plans where, as Mrs. Davis indicated, we know when the snow plowing is going to occur. We usually have some sort of notice. We know that the driveways are open for us to get to work in the morning, and that at some point during the day, usually around 1 o'clock in the afternoon, we're asked to move our cars out into the street so that each parking lot can be cleared so we can go back in. Should we not have a place to park, I'm not sure what options we would have as tenants or the landlord would have. That certainly would, the choices are limited. But I think that from that first driveway to the second driveway, I've seen it a number of times, having driven it myself, that it could be a problem. But the snow removal, having a place to park and remove our cars, it's really important to us as tenants.
Thank you. Nancy,
could I ask you
sure.
a question? About how many cars are you talking that are still there at 1 o'clock in the parking lot?
There are not that many. It depends on it depends on whether the snow falls on a Saturday or a weekday, a weekend or a weekday. Obviously, most of us are going to be home. During the weekday, chances are most of us are going to be at work, so we're talking relatively very few cars. But on weekends, I've lived here for 5 years, almost 6 years. It's never, I've never seen it to be a problem. There's plenty of room for two cars to get through with cars being parked on both sides of the road. One side? I've seen it on both sides with still having plenty of room for two cars.
Are there any other questions? Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Anyone else in the public? Yeah.
My name is Nancy Miller, and I'm also a tenant at Woodland South, and I've lived there for 13 years. They sent around a notice a couple of weeks ago about this meeting and asked us to come and speak in support of the people that run Woodland South, so that's why I'm here. My problem isn't with the parking necessarily, only in the wintertime when I have to get my car on the street. From what I've understood, what you want to do is restrict the parking for the first 1,000 feet coming in from Mitchell Road, which is where we are. In that case, I would have to put my car down the road beyond that 1,000 feet in order to get it out of the way. Obviously, they want us to get our cars out of the parking lot, and quite frankly, I don't think they really care where we put our cars as long as we get our cars out of the parking lot. I've lived there for several years, and I know that the Davises have taken care of me as a tenant, and I really want to cooperate as a tenant, and I think maybe there's a compromise here that can be worked out with the council so that maybe just during the winter months you could let us park on one side of the street as long as we're a tenant of Woodland South for a couple of hours while they clean out the parking lot. To me, I don't think that's a big inconvenience if we just have it for a short time and then we put all our cars back in. They're not going to be there any length of time, and it only takes a couple of hours for the plow to finish plowing the parking lot. I think as far as her problem that she has with people that are visiting the office, maybe they could work out something there where they could park in our parking lot or something, but that's about all I've got to say.
Thank you very much. Anyone else like to speak to the phone? Yes.
I'm Marion Perkins, also a tenant there. The widest part of Woodland Road is by the apartment section. The upper part of Woodland Road is very narrow, so if you restricted people from parking the first 1,000 feet, then the only other place we could park during snow removal would be the narrowest part of Woodland Road, which doesn't make good sense. So I think it would be much smarter if we could have a lien of some type that during a snow, after falling a snowstorm, that the people who have to have cars moved could use that section for a couple of hours. It isn't used for parking all night or all day. It's only to remove the cars out of the parking area.
Any questions? Is there anyone else from the public who would like to speak on this item? Would the Public Works Director like to address this issue? Okay, Bob.
When I was in the crew and plowing snow, I used to plow that particular area. And we always did have a particular problem with a few cars parking along in front of the Woodland Apartments. We were always calling the station and having them see if they could get them removed. It was probably, you know, 3 or 4 cars, nothing, you know, no great amount. But we always did have a straggler here and there that caused a problem. So it wasn't anything major, and they always did move the cars out after we were done plowing, but it was just during the storm we used to have a couple of stragglers that, you know, that would come in and park there. That's all.
Are you speaking in favor of having a ban as recommended by the...
Well, the worst part is, you know, where the accident occurred on that blind corner. You know, it really is blind coming up over there, and if there's a car parked there, it's it's really a hazardous situation.
Penny? Rob, are you talking about the blind corner? You're talking about when you're coming from the Cottage Farm School toward Mitchell, coming around that corner?
No, coming from Mitchell Road. Going towards Cottage Farm School.
Okay, but the corner goes that way.
Right.
So that the, it, but it's hard to see the cars parked on the right?
No, it's when you have oncoming traffic coming the other way from the Cottage Farm School, if you have a car parked there where Mrs. Davis' car was parked, it's very blind when you come around that corner. I know on a couple of occasions we've, you know, I've had to come to a complete stop and, you know, let the other oncoming traffic come.
There's a hill there too.
Yeah.
So there's no sight distance at all.
Nancy? Could you recommend a figure other than 1,000 feet where the most dangerous part of that curve would be protected by no parking and yet allow for this snow removal problem in the apartment complex?
I think once you got beyond that curve,
how many feet are you talking?
I really hate to say without measuring. It's
240.
200 to that second?
Yeah, between, it's 150 feet to the first driveway, and then it's 240 feet between the two driveways.
You know, once you get by the curve, you've got plenty of sight distance. It's just that particular curve that's real, real bad.
The road seems to be wider. Yeah.
Once you get beyond that.
Are there any other questions for Bob? Thanks a lot. Anyone else from the public would like to speak on this item? Okay, if not, I'll declare the public hearing on Woodland Road Parking closed. And after the next public hearing, we will be acting on this item. The second public hearing this evening is on a renewal of the Purputic Club liquor license. Is there anyone here tonight who wants to speak to this item? If not, Michael, maybe you would fill us in what this is all about.
This does appear to be in order. It's actually a renewal of a full-time malt spiritus vinus license and a special amusement permit. It was originally intended to be advertised for 6 days. The town clerk asked the newspaper to advertise it for 6 days. The newspaper called on Monday and said they'd only advertise it for 4 days. Because we had first thought that that would have negated the whole public hearing process, but Mrs. Pizzo spoke to the licensing division today of the Bureau of Alcoholic Beverages, and they said as long as it was a renewal, that really the council didn't have to have a public hearing anyway, according to their rules, and didn't have to act upon it, so therefore you can take action on this even with just the four-day notice. Aside from that, we know of no problems with the Purputic Club, and the police chief, myself, have no objection to your granting this permit.
Okay, thank you, Michael. All right, seeing that there's no one from the public who would like to speak on this item, I'll declare the public hearing on the Purputic Club's liquor license closed. We'll move on then to item 206 on the agenda, which is to consider citizen comments on the proposed Woodland Road parking regulation. Our ordinance committee chairman is not here, but both Nancy Mastin and Bill John serve on that committee, and maybe each of you or one of you would like to comment on the proposal.
Yield to the lady.
Well, I'm not sure that I was at this particular meeting when this was discussed. Or perhaps I was, and it wasn't discussed at great length. Do you remember, Bill, whether I was there or not?
No, I can't remember whether you was there. I don't know. I missed the last ordinance committee meeting last week. They had a meeting.
We didn't have a lengthy discussion on it, and as often happens with these ordinances, you get something before the council, and then all the problems with it come up. We didn't have the benefit of Bob Malley at that meeting, that I recall. And I think that from what I've heard tonight, that we could come up with some reasonable compromise Now I yield to you.
Thank you.
Mr. Jordan.
Now, we did discuss it, and I think our first discussion was the 250-foot mark. And then as we went through the meeting and talking to the chief and what have you, that maybe we should go all the way while we was at it. And it listened to the discussion tonight. I don't know, but I kind of have second thoughts about all of it. I didn't realize that they moved all the cars out of the parking lot. Do you do it one parking lot at a time, or do you move them all out? If I may ask Mrs. Davis for another question.
We moved them out of the big lot while they do that, and then there's this one smaller lot that I usually call them, and they bring them out afterwards when he's ready to do that lot. They're not all out at once.
So how much of the road would you say was covered with cars when they was?
Well, if it's a weekend, pretty much all of it.
Pretty much all of it. Could I ask Mr. Malley a question?
Sure.
Have you seen a problem in cleaning up and what have you when they do clean those parking lots?
Usually we're all done pushing back by the time they start moving their cars out, so it really hasn't been a problem.
You see no problem now?
No, and if the operator's down there, he usually takes care of cleaning the sidewalk at the same time, and you know, when he does his final pushback, so it really isn't a problem.
So as I understand with your presentation, about the only problem is up to the 250-foot
mark,
right, 240, where they park in front of that building. I've been by there and have looked specifically the last couple of weeks a couple of times, and they haven't, and it might be her car parked in front of that one complex each time, and I presume that's the one that you're talking about, where your office is?
Yes. I'm not parking there anymore. I'm parking in the parking lot.
Okay. But there was a couple of cars there last Monday, I think it was. I came out through there.
They don't stay there very long. When they come into my office, it's usually not more than 20 minutes or so to do business and then they leave. But the regular tenants do not park there as a general rule unless they just stop to go to their house after something or to unload their car. It's people that come to the office are the ones that would be using that room.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob.
Yeah. Other questions or comments?
I have a question. Yes. Are the people who come to the office, do they make appointments with you?
Betty, would you mind coming to the podium just so everybody can hear you?
Many times they have an appointment, yes. And a lot of times they're just walk-ins. I would say it might be 50-50.
Well, with the people with appointments, you could tell them to come in and use the parking area in the complex rather than to park on the street.
Well, yes, of course. But I still maintain that it's the speed of the cars coming down that road that is the big problem, or has been the big problem. And if this is now enforced at 25 miles an hour, I've gone through there at 25 miles an hour. I've done a lot of testing this thing in the last couple of weeks. And really, that is a spot there in front of the office that there is a little knoll, but you can, it's just a very, very short distance that would be a problem to see. And that's not a problem if you're going 25 or 30 miles an hour.
I think it's ridiculous to, with the sight distance and the width of that road, to ban parking the full 1,000 feet. I just like to move that we do ban it for that first 240 feet or to that second driveway. I can see a real problem there with coming around the turn and up. There's absolutely no sight distance there. And if there was a parked car on that hill, you'd have to pull out in the middle of the street and you'd never see something coming the other way. So I'm in favor of a ban for that first 240 feet, but not beyond that.
Yes, Martha?
Yeah, I want to make clear the numbers. You first go from the edge of Mitchell Road, from that intersection, you go 155 feet, which is the end of that first driveway, there's a, on the plan of Woodland South, it shows that there's some sort of a monument there or something. From that point, the 155 feet until the end of the next driveway, actually a couple feet beyond, because you don't want to park too close to the driveway, is 240 feet. So it's 240 feet. The language to ban parking between the two driveways would be on either side of Woodland Road, beginning 150 feet easterly of Mitchell Road, and extending 240 feet in an easterly direction. That'd be one option. A second option would be banning parking from the intersection of Mitchell all the way to the second driveway. That would be a distance of 390 feet. But the 240 is the distance between the two driveways.
Well, I think it should be banned from the intersection to that second driveway. Because you shouldn't park on the turn anyway.
Now, are you speaking of doing this during the snowstorms?
Year-round, 365 days a year, 24 hours a day.
You're going, if you do that, you're going to have cars parked way down by the cottage farms, apartments, and down in the congested area where you have a lot of houses and children playing and a narrower road, and you're not banning cars down there. Why? It's ridiculous. You can park down there, and the road is much narrower, and a lot of congestion. Houses close together. We have woods on the further side of the street, up by the apartments, and we have paid for a sidewalk all along in front of those apartments, and that sidewalk was put there to be used. Now, as far as the parking, this 250 feet, it's only about 200 feet that would be any problem at all. You could park probably six cars from the end of this Arlington building to that second entrance, and everybody could see.
Okay. Yes, Lester?
Well, as I looked at it fairly closely, as I see it, from that 200 and, well, from that second driveway to, say, the middle of the hill, almost to where Cottage Farm School used to be, I would estimate you probably, parking on both sides, you could almost put 40 cars there. And so I don't see the problem, and that's before you're getting to the narrow part. And if you took 40 cars out of a parking lot, that would leave plenty of room to push snow back, and then after you get that snow pushed back, you could put those 40 cars in the parking lot, if you have more than 40 cars, and clean it up. I don't see it.
Well, on a weekend, there is apt to be more, because there's 54 apartments, and a good many of them have two cars.
Thank you. Are there other questions or comments? Penny.
In order to be somewhat consistent with the previous discussions that we've had on parking on a variety of streets that have come up this past, I'd say, year and a half or 2 years, certainly we've had some real problem areas, and we have tried to deal with those in a fair and equitable manner. Especially in the Maiden Cove area and in the Kettle Cove area. But like other parking discussions that we have, I really begin to see, again, that we begin to over-regulate. It is difficult for me to believe the number of years that Mitchell Road and Woodland Road have intersected with school children for the previous 50 years, and we have not seemed to have dealt with this number in any previous councils. Now we have an accident that is questionable as to the cause of it, whether it's the driver's lack of driving properly, or just how much a parked car might have had to do with it. And I begin to see, because of this incident, we are now beginning to overregulate. I have a great deal of difficulty with that. I cannot understand I don't know how long those apartments, I forget how long those apartments have been there, why we should get involved in this. Why, if we put 390 feet, as Lester suggested, which is a reasonable compromise to this thing, On every intersection, on every corner, off to every main artery that we turn around, we'd be so busy in trying to enforce this parking regulation, it would be ridiculous. Because goodness knows, if you come up Oak Ridge Road on that corner before you take a bend there, there's no parking signs there. And that is a difficult corner as you come around there, coming off Shore Road. People are coming fast, people are coming down the road, the church has parking lots there. I just don't understand how we can go along regulating parking in these residential areas, and every single time we run into incidents, it just kind of rubs me the wrong way when I think of the very narrow roads that we have in many areas of this town where there are houses on both sides of those roads, and school buses stopping, and children walking to school buses, and bicycles going by, and it's never come up before. Now we have a wide road with a wide intersection and some apartments on one side. Now it seems to me that it is, the chairman suggested, or whoever it was, that if there's an appointment being made with Mrs. Davis, she could say, will you please come in at 10 o'clock to please park in parking lot one or whatever the thing is. And the tenants need to maybe have a letter saying that this is of great concern, and that the landlords are recommending that no cars be parked except for snow removal, let's say, or whatever, on Woodland Road. We might try a more conservative approach to this without this constant regulation of citizens' use of public ways. Now, we've had a lot of accidents in this town. There are some corners in this town that you've had several accidents on. We don't do anything there. We just maybe put a chevron arrow pointing sign if it's a sharp corner. I just feel uncomfortable with this beginning to, I feel like we're over-regulating all the time, and I feel very strongly about that. Certainly there should be absolutely, snow removal or otherwise, no parking between Mitchell Road and at least the turning to the first driveway. Nobody can park on a corner or an intersection anywhere. I mean, just you don't do that. I just hope that maybe we could control it by then writing a letter to their tenants, and then being aware of it themselves, and by appointment-making purposes, and give that a shot on a conservative approach rather than the constant regulation, which is difficult for our police department to constantly enforce all these things. That's just my opinion, so I probably will vote no on this.
Lester?
Well, I think Penny's, in this instance, this seems to be, to me, a unique intersection, a unique place, because as you make that turn, you're going uphill, and the sight distance isn't even a car and a half. You can't see anything. I'm not saying ban parking on all streets, but this particular spot, and I just want to get beyond that danger spot. Other than that, I'd hate to ban parking there, because that's a straight, wide street. And if you wanted to compromise, or say, and only do it a certain time of year, I think the winter time is the worst time, because then you're going to have slippery, icy roads. So I think that particular area should be banned. I'm not for making new ordinances. Never have.
True.
But I think there's a bad situation there on that hill and curve.
I'd like to mention at this time that we are in receipt of three letters, one from a Margaret Richard, who is concerned about the parking ban, and particularly because of the same reasons that have already been mentioned during the public hearing, because of snow removal. Also, Richard Davis is opposed to any ban at all on Woodland Road. And also we have a letter from Betty Davis, and she already very eloquently made her point. I'd just like to mention at this time that those are the letters that I received. Does anyone have any other letters besides or any input from residents? Okay. Is there any more discussion, or are we prepared for a motion at this time? Yes, Nancy?
Well, I just want to say that I think it's kind of unfair, since the chairman of the ordinance committee is not here tonight to defend himself eloquently, as he usually does, and I would be prepared to make a motion that we return this proposed ordinance to the ordinance committee, and that the committee have a site visit.
You should have, anyway.
Is there a second to the motion?
Could I say?
Well,
okay.
Is anybody going to second that motion?
Okay, if not, does someone have another motion I'd like to propose, Lester?
Yes, I'd like to move that we ban parking on both sides of the road, on Woodland Road, from the intersection of Mitchell to just beyond the second driveway, which, and the footage you can put in later, which is...
390.
390? All right, 390 feet on both sides.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second it.
Okay, discussion. Bill?
I have a question more or less to the manager as a legal question. The ordinance has been advertised as 1,000 feet, but we can reduce it and not exceed 1,000 feet. Is that the correct way of doing it?
This is within, this section that's now being proposed is within what you were proposing. It's a lesser effect. There's no reason that you'd have to hold another public hearing for a lesser action.
So it's legal to go down to 390 feet or something to that effect?
Yes.
Okay.
Not being, that's not a legal opinion.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, Nancy?
I don't think it's right for us to be rewriting ordinances in council meetings.
We've done it a lot of times.
Yeah. I don't think it's right.
I don't.
Any other comments?
If I
Bill?
May, I just answer Councilor Matheson. I don't think what you'd say rewriting it. That's why I asked the question to the manager. I was quite sure that you'd be really rewriting it if you was going to go to 1,500 feet. But if you're within 1,000 feet, which is what was advertised, I wouldn't say we're rewriting it. We're bringing it back to a smaller distance.
You're making an amendment.
Okay.
No, I was going to respond also that historically we have done these kind of small changes, and even when the lawyer has been here, we've addressed the questions to him. We've very often been able to make these small changes because it generally does not adversely affect the ordinance or the people who will be affected by the ordinance. So I understand your point about rewriting them. I think in this instance, it's not quite enough for me to be concerned that it is a rewritten part.
I guess I would look upon it as reacting to the comments that we heard tonight and reacting within the ordinance as it was proposed. And I know what you're saying, because we have sometimes gotten into trouble trying to change the wording of ordinances the night of a meeting and then have that come back to haunt us. But I think in this particular item, because we're just decreasing the amount of footage, that we're not really changing the meeting. Anyone else?
Just ask one question. I know you've all been waiting for me to start talking. Is this the
minimum? I knew it would happen eventually.
Is this the minimum site distance that would be required to reduce parking? Because I'm concerned about over-regulating the parking situation. If we only need to shut down parking to that first driveway because of site distance, then I just want to shorten it up to that first driveway. If we need to go halfway between the driveways, I would like to see that this is new, because as far as I'm aware, this is the only accident that's really been critical in that area, to go to minimum distance necessary. And if it doesn't work, then it certainly will be before us in the spring. That, I guess, would be my question. I didn't measure it, so I don't know what the distance is.
Mike, do you want to respond to that?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that you already, by ordinance, cannot park within 20 feet of an intersection. You cannot, so that takes care of the first 20 feet. As far as the absolute minimum, I think the absolute minimum is between the two driveways, if you feel there's a public safety problem that you want to address. You're adding an additional about 130, 120 feet between Mitchell and the first driveway. If the council feel that's necessary, fine, but I think if you want to take minimal action to address public safety, you don't necessarily have to do that small 120-foot space.
To Mitchell Road?
Between Mitchell Road and the first driveway. From 20 feet from Mitchell Road to the first driveway was not a public safety concern to either the chief or to me. Others may see this one, but we didn't see this
okay,
one.
Okay, but we have ordinances, I think, that prohibit parking on hills and rises and roads already, and if this particular site distance problem is already regulated, then it should be already signed. We should be mean, state regulations must say you can't park on hills.
I think about all the ordinance says is on the paved or improved surface of any streetway or road when it is practicable to park elsewhere. You know, that sounds like nice wording, but I've never known the police to give a ticket out on the basis of that wording. It doesn't hold up very well.
But they will begin a ticket any car that happens to stop and run in to see, is this the right office to go to Woodland South? They could be ticketed while they're finding that out, could they not? I mean, this is what's going to happen, right? If the police were to enforce the regs on that.
If you passed an ordinance and it was posted correctly, no parking, that is what would happen.
It's hard for me to believe that we would potentially allow parking. If you turn around the corner, you've got 20 feet. 20 feet is what, a car and a half? Two cars or something like that?
Two at the moment.
And then we would allow some parking between there and the first driveway. That seems like a foolish place to allow some parking. And it stops between the two driveways.
Yeah, I guess the question, you know, Councilor Tinsman asked what is the absolute minimum for public safety, and that's really what it fits.
Is there any further discussion? Are we ready to vote on this motion?
Can I just ask, is there nobody on the council that feels that, since this is the first time this has come up, I mean, the first time we've really addressed it like this, that nobody wants to try a conservative approach to this, where we work with the landlords of the Woodland South, and that we make some effort to address this conservatively? Is there anyone else that doesn't apparently want to do that?
When you say that, what do you mean, no parking? No, allow parking anywhere?
Well, since the majority of the parking is related to the apartment buildings, why can't we try a conservative approach and see if Mr. and Mrs. Davis can work with their tenants, explaining what's been going on at the meeting here, and allow them to move their cars out there during the winter time when the snow is removed? We're talking 1 or 2 hours on an occasional weekday or an occasional weekend. Of course, we could get a bad winter, it could be more often than that. I mean, we're regulating a lot for a minimum amount of problem.
Well, if in fact this is the safety problem that it seems to be from what everyone says, I think that by allowing people to park out there in the winter right after a snowstorm is not what we should be in the business of doing either as public policy makers. Lester?
Yeah, I don't see how we can ask the Davises to control the parking of there. A lot of the times, it's not just the snow plowing. People are coming there and stopping and parking, and they can't run out and police that driveway, that roadway for us and say, please don't park there. As I see it, because we have a motion on the floor, but if you don't like the motion on the floor, I suggest that the council, maybe you could table it and the council go and take a look at that area. If you haven't seen it, it probably you shouldn't be voting on it anyway.
Okay, we do have a motion on the floor. Does anyone have anything new to add to the discussion? Okay, if not, all those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? And the motion carries 42.
So what have we got? 390 feet?
395 feet. 90. 90. 90. Feet. All right, item 207 is to consider a request from the Pacific Club for a full-time mall, spiritus, and fitness license and special amusement permit. Michael? Anything else to add?
No.
The permit is in order. All we need is a motion to grant the request.
I move that we grant the request.
Okay. Bill is seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? The motion carries 6-1.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
We had a special meeting. We had some minutes of a special meeting. Did we approve that?
No, we did not.
Did you want to?
Yes.
I move that we approve the minutes of November 16, 1987.
Second.
Any discussion?
As written.
All those in favor? Mm-hmm. Thank you, Nancy. All right, item 208 is to consider authorizing final design and negotiation for acquisitions of rights of way for a proposed reconstruction of a portion of Sawyer Road and of Pickett Street. We did have a
I think it was last month, two proposals before us. The council asked if there were not some other way of addressing the problem of reconstruction on Sawyer and Pickett Road. Our town engineer, Bob Hunter, is here. He did present to us two other options. The council did go down to the site and did discuss the two new options. We do also have the cost for all four of those options tonight. And I'm going to ask the town manager to briefly go over those four options for us at this point. And Bob, you can chime in when necessary. Michael?
You have four options before you. They're all back here on the wall. I would like to mention that these do show the road at still at the earlier proposed full width, and it's now proposed to be 30 feet of pavement rather than, what did this show, 38, Bob?
36,
and it would actually be 30 at this point. There are several different options. Why don't we start with this one? This is option one. This darker orange you see is the existing road. Where you see the yellow is the proposal under option one. Under option one, Sawyer Road would continue in a straight intersection. Straight alignment up into Pickett. That would be the predominant traffic flow. The estimated cost of that is $975,000. A disadvantage to that, and one the council addressed earlier, is the fact that it would cause quite a bit of impact to the Young property, which is situated right above where my hand is, all over this area, and particularly take out a very large piece of rock there. The second option that was looked at was option, we're calling tonight option two, and this shows Pickett Street coming into a stop sign onto Sawyer Road, and Sawyer Road would still be the predominant traffic flow. There'd be a stop sign here at the intersection of at the bottom of Pickett Street. Somewhat similar to the current alignment, except you get rid of that crazy traffic island situation that's now there, to excuse the editorial comment. Option three, the one up above here, is very close to option one, except the road just swings out a slight bit further away from the rock and has quite a bit less of an impact on the Young property. You can see the distance between the really salmon color from there to there is the difference. Most of the road would almost be pushed, I would say that shows about 25 feet further away from the Young property. Item four, option four, so over here is very close to option three, only it puts even more of a curve and pushes up further, but still has the primary alignment Sawyer into Pickett is the major flow of traffic. In summary, as far as the options and cost, option one, this one is estimated at, for construction cost, $975,000. Option two is $50,000 less, $925,000. Option three is $960,000. And option four is $930,000. In addition to that, the cost of appraisals, acquisition of rights of way, et cetera, could be as high as $200,000. We would hope it wouldn't be that much, but we're estimating for each of these projects, if you take those amounts and add $200,000 to it. Would you like me, in addition to the options, go into a little bit of the background of, or would you not want me to do that?
Does anybody feel a need to hear any more about the background? I guess we'll pass on the background.
I would like to say one
thing. Heard it before.
If with the council's indulgence, I would like to say one thing. You know, what we're asking for at this point is not the final design. What we're asking for is a concept for the final design. For instance, you know, if you wanted to take option two here, you know, you could give whatever general instructions you want toward the final design, but have that serve as the basis, with the understanding that the actual final design would come back to you for approval at a later date. You would at that same time have to have approval to go forward with the bidding process and to really get the thing moving. So, you know, this tonight, you know, if you did move to go ahead, would not be the final vote that you have on this, but what it would do is result in a substantial investment of funds for engineering, and we would actually begin the process of acquiring the 50-foot right-of-way that would be required for whatever option that you decided to go forward with. We would incur appraisal expenses, and there would be significant negotiations take place with the residents all along the area. So, it, you know, it would be a major step, but it wouldn't be the final committal step on it. You would have to approve each of those agreements for rights-of-way as well.
Thank you, Mike. Is there anyone from the public who would like to speak on this item? No? Okay. I just wanted to make sure. Any councilors who have questions, comments at this time? Phil?
Yes. I have a question, and I don't know whether I should go to Mr. Hunter or the manager. My question is, and I've been thinking about it quite a lot lately, and I'm inclined now to lean towards having the alignment as far as Sawyer Street to continue that way and have a stop sign on Fickett Street coming into Sawyer Street, because I think as I look at it and take a sight as you come down over the hill, we're going to create a tremendous speedway affair, because they're going to zoom down. They can come right down over the hill and right straight through, and the people coming in the other way with a stop sign. That would be two. Am I correct?
Yes, that's correct. Option two continues the basic flow of traffic continuing along Sawyer Street with Fickett Street coming in at a stop sign. The other three options all carry the primary traffic through up over the hill.
Okay, now with option two, does that take more off of the corner than three or four by Sunny's End?
Option two would basically put the right-of-way acquisition over on the other side of the road in the field area. Option two, I don't believe, would encroach on the Young's property at all. But it would encroach some 25 feet or more into the field area, which is on the other side of the street. That's where the row of large trees go around the corner. And option two, as shown, would push the roadway out beyond the trees, and actually all the trees that are now on that curve would come down, and the edge of the roadway would be out into the field, maybe 20 or 25 feet.
Okay.
How many trees are we talking about coming down?
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13.
Oh, 15 or more trees.
All of them?
Basically all of them would come down with that option, yes.
Okay. Now, if you went back to option three, I think it is, that puts the center line of the road right about where the hydrant is, or is that four?
Option three, yes. That would be, as we looked at it in the field that day, I indicated that the center line of option three would be about where the hydrant is located.
Okay. If you did that, why could you still have Fickett Street with a stop sign and let them curve around onto Sawyer Street as a main drag?
Well, if I could refer to
yeah.
the plan, perhaps, the option three that you have, again, this is Sawyer Street and this is Fickett Street, and shown the primary traffic goes through. Now, normally in traffic engineering and traffic circulation, what you're going to do is to stop the side street coming in. I think what you were suggesting is having this come up, put a flow this way, we're still put a stop sign there, so someone coming down over the hill has to stop at this location before passing through the intersection.
That's right.
And this here presumably would just flow out and go. I think part of the problem is with this that this person coming up here, the sight distance seeing a car coming down the hill is not going to be very good. And I think the tendency is for most drivers are going to look at this as a flow way, and a stop sign at this location is going to be a non-typical and an unexpected event. And if a car, if there's no stop sign on Sawyer Street and the car can simply come up and go out, I think that you are increasing the chances for you're creating an accident prone condition at that intersection. I think if in fact you want Sawyer Street to remain the primary thrust, then you have to ease the curve so that you have a normal flow of cars, such as shown on here, on option two, which makes this a normal flow, and someone coming down over Baker Street and turning here is expecting and will have a stop sign at that location. So I think from a traffic movement and a traffic safety standpoint, if you in fact do want to stop Baker Street as they come down the hill, that you would have to take some sort of an alignment such as this with a stop sign at this location.
Michael?
Bob, couldn't you take this here and just move it up a little bit upward? You'd be able to save some of those trees?
Yes, I don't like to second guess, but I think at the last meeting we had, I raised the question as to whether that was an option that you wanted us to look at, and I was given the instructions not to do that. But basically, what Mr. McGovern is suggesting is that you sharpen this curve and bring the roadway out into the field much more so that you don't in fact have to take all of those trees, but you can save at least part of them at that location. This would move the whole roadway out into the field. Now obviously that increases the right-of-way taking off the field that you have, but you would probably save at least some of the trees that would be taken in this alignment here. But that could probably be done to ease it so that you didn't take the entire row of trees that you have.
So if I may.
Lester, get back to
you. Well, why can't you leave the center of the road just as it is over there now and just widen it a little bit, and it wouldn't be quite so drastic, and have that stop sign coming down Pickett and all? Why can't you use the same center line, so to speak?
Well, as it is right now, as you go around that curve, those trees block the sight distance, so you do not have adequate sight distance going around the corner because of the trees being there. And also, if you keep it over this way, then as you come down over the steep hill on Pickett Street, what we really want to do is move the intersection away a little bit so we can come down and have a little bit of a stop platform at the bottom rather than having one coming directly down and having a very sharp grade at the intersection. So by pulling it out this way, we can ease the grade in here, and we do get the sight distance that would be a standard accepted sight distance around the corner.
Well, as I see it, if you want to follow your thinking here on that design, looking at those trees haven't got too much more life anyway, so maybe we should just take the trees down and plant new ones.
Yes, they are very large, old trees.
They're going to die in a few years anyway.
I'm not qualified to judge what the life of the trees are, but they are mature, old trees.
I still have a problem with funneling the traffic on Sawyer Road towards Route 77. It's a very thickly settled area. The road gets very narrow, and 77 is already overloaded. I just don't see any sense in having that be the emphasis. I prefer the thick.
No, going up the thick is the emphasis. Even though
having that be the straightaway, I don't know quite how to say it, but you traffic engineers know what I mean.
Well, the options, say 1, 3, and 4, coming through, this encourages, or this assumes that the primary movement is going to, and it's going to tend to direct traffic that's coming in town on Sawyer Road into South Portland via Pickett Street. The other option is going to tend to encourage people to go in using Sawyer Street in towards Stillman or down to Route 77. And I agree, if you, from here on down, from this location down to Stillman Road and Route 77, the road is very narrow, it's built up, only fairly close to the road, and I think it would be extremely difficult, really, to upgrade Sawyer Street from here on down through. And it's going to be very difficult to do much with it.
Pat?
Pat?
Yeah. Initially, I was very concerned with the width and the throughway that we were going to be creating from Sawyer and through Fickett. It reminded me of when you go on a roller coaster and right at the end of the ride, you go through this little bumps in action to stop you. Well, that's exactly the action you have when you go over Fickett in this new improved speedway. And you get in South Pole and you'd be bouncing off the side and slowing down by the stop sign at the bottom of the hill. I fully support option two. That will cause a natural stopping order. People are still going to go across Fickett if you want to go Fickett, and they're still going to go Sawyer if they want to go Sawyer. That stop sign at the end of Fickett will act as a speed bump, if you will. It will stop people, then they will proceed down Fickett or proceed down Sawyer in an orderly manner, and perhaps they won't have a chance to pick up speed quite so bad as they would in a throughway. As you go on Sawyer Road from Fickett towards Route 77, it doesn't become heavily congested as you get into South Portland. And again, we're all familiar with that corner where the road goes around someone's front lawn and there's a problem with ever making the road wider there. But from Sawyer Road, from Fickett to Route 77, there's plenty of room on the southern side to gain additional width on that whole road. I don't know why you'd ever want to, but there's certainly the option to do that. There's plenty of room between the road and where the houses are, and it's not really that rough a terrain. Initially, I would be in favor of moving the turn of Sawyer Road to leave those trees. But if it was determined that the trees are mature enough so that their life expectancy wasn't going to be worth the additional monies for the right-of-way and everything else, I would be in favor of cutting those trees and planting some new trees that will get many more years of life in and act as a natural barrier there. But I would fully support option two. I'm not sure that I would fund it this fiscal year, but I would fully support it. And I would hope that the council would go in that direction.
Yes, Bill?
I just brought this up with the idea. I didn't want to have to go back and send Bob Hunter back for a redesign here. I just brought the idea of some way we could stop the traffic from coming down Fickett Street and continuing down Sawyer with a speedway type affair, and I think that's what we're going to have if we make a straight road up over Fickett Street. I'm just so afraid of that, and I'm very much in favor of correcting the problem over there, and it is just some way that we could take that little kink out of Fickett Street and fix up the corner and fix up the road. I think we could solve the problem, but I don't think in redoing Fickett Street and redoing that part of Sawyer Street and putting a stop sign there and having Sawyer as the main traffic flow is going to send people out onto 77 any more than they do now. There's a lot of people come down over there and go over and go down Eastman Road and out onto Spilling that live in that direction. Once they got going the way they do now, I don't think it would send them around to 77. Who wants to go down and get into that horror show going down into Knightville through Ocean Street? That's just about what it is. If they ever build a bridge, it's going to be a worse one. And I think that someday maybe South Pole will fix up Fickett Street up there where the S is. But I know they're going to have a problem doing it. But I would like to see some way that we could slow the traffic up at that intersection without going through a whole redesign of the whole project.
I don't think anyone knows where the through town highway is going to go in the future or what South Portland is going to do. They may come out, Evans Extension or something, and come out onto Sawyer Hollow. We may be building a road across country to further out on Highland Avenue. And I doubt very much if we ever have a real thorough way going up Ficket. So I think I like the alignment of option two. And maybe in the future, if South Portland does do something there, and that is the main drag, I don't think it would cost much beyond what we're doing now to do what you want to. But I think it's senseless to make that a thoroughway when maybe nothing will ever happen in that area.
I'll tell you, I could not vote for option two. Option two, to me, is the most undesirable because it eliminates the rural character of that road by eliminating all those trees. And the last time we discussed this, everybody wanted to save the trees. Now, all of a sudden, they're ready to chop them down and put up some new ones. And I'm not prepared to do that, so I wouldn't be prepared to vote for option two. I know that something needs to be done on that road, and I'm not yet convinced that that the Sawyer thoroughfare should be the main focus of the traffic. I agree with Nancy that people are going up Ficket Street. That's where most of the traffic is going. And it seems to me it only makes sense that the road ought to be built to encourage traffic in the area, in the mode that people are using it, and not try to change the habit. But I'd like to do, I'd like to see us consider an option that does not affect the Young property the way option one did, and look at either option three or four, or maybe some other option. But option two, to me, is the least desirable. Penny, we haven't heard from you. And I would like to say, before we hear from Penny, I did get a call just before I left from a resident on Sawyer Road saying, I hope you will do nothing. So I should share that with you. Because we have received several letters from people saying that something does need to be done on the road. But this one person did say she'd rather have nothing done than have rights of way taken.
Why don't you answer Nancy's question?
I got a call too, and it was with regard to taking land. And I think we should all hear a little more specifically about that. How much land would have to be taken, because they will put some houses closer to the road. Some of them will lose trees. If they have in mind future expansion, for example, it might make that possible. Could you tell us?
Do you want to stay with the 24-foot or 30?
The town, perhaps the right-of-way of the road, what we'd be looking to acquire, would be 50 feet. That is what's required on every road, new road in Cape Elizabeth now, including minor little streets and minor little subdivisions. Currently, the right-of-way on Sawyer Road is 33 feet. That means, with the one exception of however we get through this intersection, we would be needing to acquire an average of, a total of 17 feet. If it was split on either side, that'd be 8.5 feet either side. In some cases, it's going to be 10 feet on one side, 7 on another. It'll vary somewhat. The final design will be done in such a way so that it will have minimal impact as it goes through there. If there's something specifically significant that needs to be saved on the left, the road will veer a little to the right, and vice versa.
Now, where are you talking?
But you can see here, it's threading the needle.
Are you talking just at this intersection area?
The whole
road. The whole shebang.
The whole shebang. And I don't think there's sense of doing any project unless you acquire the 50-foot right-of-way. There's no room for snow. I wouldn't do anything at all to this road without 50 feet.
But you stressed earlier that this is not the final design, that it's just a concept. Really what we need to decide is the intersection there and how we want it to go.
You need to decide the whole project, whether or not you want to move forward.
Whether it goes or not.
Yes, and then within that.
The four concepts are not so much the rest of the road, it's that intersection.
The concept will be The final design will be very close to the concept. You know, I think everyone ought to know what's coming up. But, you know, in stressing that it may be slightly different, you know, I want to make the point that when we do the final design and when we have negotiations with all the persons with the rights of way, you know, I'd like to do it in a way that if they have a healthy suggestion that's easy to do, that we do it. That we not get totally tied down. We try to get the best project for the town as a whole as well as for the residents. And that's really what I intend, my intention in saying that this is not final, that if there's a little shift we can do during the final design, if it doesn't have an adverse impact, I think we should do it.
And the other comment was that it would become, when you fix the road, it would become a speedway. You were going to say that, weren't you, Councilor Carson?
Well, I probably would have touched upon that.
Do you want to say something else?
That is not my, well, concern. So,
as the council knows from our previous discussion of this item, that I am against all the concepts. It's the concept of the road. I just tried to visualize on a drawing what it would be like to assume that we took by eminent domain a 50-foot right-of-way down that rural road. And I'll tell you something, if any of those houses, some of those houses have a bedroom on the front of the house, it'll be like having a car going, you know, at the end of the bedroom door, because it's going to be pretty close there. I just feel, and maybe it's because of my position on the Comprehensive Planning Committee, I just believe that this is an affront to a previous comprehensive planning position that we had. And I believe it will be an affront to this present comprehensive planning committee that we have. To take a road such as this and create a 30-foot strip of tar down the middle, advancing on people's front lawns, taking down trees. Some houses will lose their shrubs and like a hedge across the front of their house for I don't know what. This is not the main entrance way into this community or out of this community. Now, maybe it will be in 20 years. I don't know. It's hard to believe, but there were some councilors that are concerned about taking the road and having it be Sawyer Road, be the main direction of it, because Sawyer Road narrows down through a heavily residential Sylvan Sites area. Houses very close together. Now, that road is narrow down there. On the same token, if you were to take it up Fickett Road, it equally is narrow, and there's building going on to that South Portland side of Fickett Road. So again, you're taking a large flow of traffic because you're trying to build a road to handle a large flow of traffic, taking on a Fickett Road, a small country road, cutting through between two more main roads where there are houses on it, and taking them off a 30-foot road and narrowing it down to two lanes. I mean, it doesn't even sound like a safe project to me. It's hard for me to believe that I can stand at that section of the intersection of Fickett Road, look down toward those farmlands, look down toward those houses, and see a 30-foot strip of black tar with a yellow line down the middle and curbs. It's just, I vowed that I wasn't going to say this because I think the most of you knew what my opinion is. It just seems like too much, too big, too wide, too long, too everything on a little narrow road. And it's hard for me to believe. Maybe I can't adjust to the changes. Maybe after living in this community all my life, it's hard for me maybe I just have forward thinking enough to adjust to these kinds of changes. It just seems too much, too big, too long, too wide, too everything to me to go by these people's houses. And I was there on the road today, and I know that there's something that needs to be done to the drainage. Those people have a problem there. I'm not sure that every single person on that section is anxious for us to do that. I'm really not convinced of that. Granted, they have not come forward, but in other items historically, people have not come forward, and so it's hard. You know, I have not, sometimes in the past, I have knocked on people's doors and asked them all, and I did not do that on this item. Not that that might sway, you know, I don't know whether that would sway me or not. It is my personal opinion. I'm certainly in a minority on this. I did go over a couple of other roads in this community that I thought were also in not very good condition, and I wonder what it would be like if we took those roads and widened them up to 30 feet, put a yellow line down the middle, and two nice four-foot things. And you can be sure that if this road is completed, it won't be within 1 to 3 or 5 years that we will be back at this council discussing whether or not to put a parking ban on that road. Because we're going to have, you know, a road and now two tarred shoulders on either side, and it won't be safe for one of the people in those houses to park their car in front of their house, and this council is going to be discussing that again. And then we just, and maybe this is the direction the council should be taking. Maybe this is the direction our community should be taking. We're a growing community. Maybe we should be putting these tarred shoulders on either side and addressing parking on each road. But by God, we're going to have people that can only drive to their house, into their driveway, go in the house and shut the door because they're going to be limited on doing things. I just have a bad sense about it, and I'm very sorry that I carried on so long. I won't be voting. I probably will vote against this.
Are you making a motion to keep the road the same width as it presently is?
I'm intrigued to think that there is this possibility. do you mean to not go for a 30-foot?
Yeah, are you proposing to keep it the same width as the permanent, as the pavement is today? Redo the road, but when it's finished, it's the same width as it is presently?
Well, I don't know how wide that road is right now. I suspect that we've been probably widening that road a little bit in our preparation, in our repairing the drainage problems.
33 feet.
Okay. I'd ask the council, please, to ask to be recognized before they start.
Well, I want to answer a question.
Go ahead, Bill.
I just want to answer. I hope you rode on Wells Road while you was going up
the
Soy Street. And I would hope that this town will have foresight enough to take some of these roads before the houses get there and get them wide enough for that big plan that you're working on, before they build the houses and then want to take in their bedrooms as you just discussed. Now, I hate to see Sonny lose any land over there, and I don't think he's going to lose much to speak of, and also on the other side of the road. But I feel, if you feel that road is going to be a artillery road for the town of Cape Elizabeth, now is the time to do something with it. Now, I don't think you're going to hurt those people down there in the hollow that you're speaking of, that their cars are going by the bedroom. But I think the drainage was fixed there, and they had a curbing. They would have a much better situation than they have now, because I went by there the day after the rain, and I believe I was riding with Mr. Malley and the town manager and what have you. I said, I think we could fit our Denison's lawn with that swimming pool if we had a little drainage there. And there was that much water in places all over the front of his lawn. So now maybe he's against the road. And I think he was at one time against the road when it was the original concept as far as having, I guess, 32 or 34 feet. 32, wasn't it?
38.
38. Okay. But since it's narrowed down, he says, I understand something should be done. And he says, I think I would be in favor of it. And now is the time, in my opinion, before they build houses, and they're going to build some houses right across the street from Sonny, and I don't think it's too far down the line, let's get it straightened out or get the land before they put a house up next to the road, and then you'll want to be driving by their bedroom.
Yes, Nancy?
Is there any way that, I tend to agree with you, Bill. I think we really ought to look to the future, not the past. And no matter how emotional we feel about our country road, we are dealing with safety too. And I just wonder, and I am concerned about the houses that will be made closer to the road. Is there any way of designing this road so that to disturb the present properties as little as possible, taking land or purchasing in the field rather than settled lots, and might put a little wiggle in the road, which might discourage the racetrack.
Yes, well, obviously, when we were coming up with these plans, we were fully cognizant of the impact that this potentially has on the homeowners that live in that area. And the alignment that we have shown basically makes the attempt to weave or put the road down through there with minimum impact on the abutting properties. Now, as it is shown on the plan that you see, it is based on a 36-foot wide area. And in that case, you notice through the populated areas, if you will, where the houses are, that there are essentially no trees that we would anticipate having to take in that area. There's one or two minor shrubs that would probably have to be moved. By going from the 36 feet down to the 30 feet, that obviously is going to make it easier in the final design to put the alignment through the area, again, to minimize the impacts on the adjacent property. And this would be keeping back from the houses to the extent possible, minimizing the amount of trees, if any, that you have to take, the shrubbery that you have to take. So I think the plan, as you see, we did a fairly thorough survey to come up with these plans, and the trees are fairly accurately located, and I think as you look over the entire route, there really aren't very many trees in the built-up area that are going to have to come down. As far as the setbacks from the homes, yes, obviously, if you I think right now there's probably a 21, 22-foot wide paved area going through there. So if it's 22 feet and we're going to end up with 30 feet, then theoretically that's moving the edge of the paving of the curb line. Is if it went right down the center, it would be 4 feet closer to the home than what the area is now. But certainly during the design, one of the key aspects would be to try to locate it so you're going to minimize the impacts that that we would have. And I think with the 30-foot paved way that we can go down through there and keep the impacts to a very nominal amount.
And my other question is, do we have to have curbs?
Well, this has been kicked around, and I think that our opinion is, yes, you do, and I think that our opinion is that the abutting homeowners are going to be somewhat better off by having curbs. Now, by curbs, we're not talking about the granite curb or the high vertical curb. We're thinking of a rather shallow, low type of curb whose purpose is primarily to keep the water from the street, within the street, carry it to a catch basin and be able to carry it in a pipe to a discharge point. If we don't have curbs but just have shoulders, then we're going to get water in many places sheeting from the road off onto the adjacent lawn areas. And we also need to have underdrained pipes under the road in any case, because of the type of soil and the high groundwater condition we have. We have to install the pipes as underdrains to control the groundwater. So with the pipes in place, the proper drainage design would be to take the surface water from the street into the pipes also and prevent it from sheeting out onto the private property. So in this particular case, due to the soil conditions and again due to the drainage that is necessary to go in, we feel fairly strongly that a curb design is going to be the would be the best approach to the situation. You simply can't do it with an open ditch system. If you had an open ditch and you built the ditches to normal town standards, then the back slopes of those ditches would encroach onto the properties for several feet, and I think that that would have a much larger impact on the homes than putting in the curb section would be.
Bob, what the stormwater picked up on the dirt from the new drains that go into this road,
yes,
will be taken out on the back side of those houses or where that residential is, and it will be dropped into some brook. What is the status of that brook? If we're going to put that sort of salty road drainage water into a freshwater brook. What is that brook that's out there in what appears to be sort of a wet area, a wildlife sort of wetty, soggy area?
There are two locations where the drainage would be discharged. The first one would be almost across from where Silver Drive intersection is at this time. There's an existing culvert that comes under the pipe here and a natural swale that goes out through the woods. The drainage in the upper area would be discharged at that point. The other drainage discharge point is in a swale now that comes down under the road and down beside the Young's Field, I believe. This is a more pronounced and carrying a little more water than the shallow one up here. This would simply be piped out and discharged to this water course, which eventually continues down and goes into the spillway estuary eventually. Now the drainage from any road that you have carries in the wintertime, carries salt and debris and so forth, and that in fact will be discharged out. But normally that occurs with fairly heavy flow or runoff, and it's sufficient and it will carry it down through. So certainly there could be some impact on the water quality, whether you're supposed to bring it in a pipe or whether it sheets off or how it gets there. Any drainage off on a roadway carries certain things with it that are going to go through the brook.
Right now, though, it leaches all along the length of the road. Now we're going to take it all and run it into...
It eventually gets down to the Spillway Marsh, but it has to go in, it's stored in people's lawns, and then it gets out and goes this way and that way. So, yes, by piping it, you're providing a more direct, concentrated discharge at 2 points, rather than having it kind of sheet through the yards and out the back at this time.
Nancy?
Bob, you have to get a permit to discharge into the stream and into the estuary.
Well, we're not going to the estuary. It's quite a long ways from here down to the estuary. I guess my answer would be, I don't think so, but I wouldn't want to give an absolute thing here on the board. I wouldn't want to say no.
Probably.
Normally, I think...
check it out.
Normally, highway drainage discharge boards and so forth would normally not require.
It was new to the area.
Well,
Doug, you have another question.
Just to follow up on that, of course, the salt would be discharging into a salt body.
We don't use salt.
It's freshwater brook. It's quite a ways from the Spur River.
Not too far.
It's not far. I wouldn't guess, but
it helps the saltwater clams.
You don't mind putting the salt.
Can't believe that because
you don't mind putting the salt in the pond I irrigate out of. That don't bother you.
Doug, just a second. Doug, go ahead.
Okay, as you know, initially I was very concerned about even changing the road to 36 feet. It's been narrowed down to 30. I don't know why it can't be narrowed down even further. 24 or 26 feet is still a wide road. The type of curbing that Bob and Mike are talking about is the new Cape Cod, I assume, curbing.
Yes, berm curb.
Which is at about a 45 degree angle, and it's made to drivable. The good part about this curbing is it doesn't clear off when you're plowing the snow, and that you should leave it in front of your driveway so that you will have a retention ahead of your driveway. You drive over it into your driveway. The cars right now park, if they need to park on Sawyer Road, they park on the lawns. With this Cape Cod curbing, it'll retain your water flow, keep it out of their driveways, keep it out of their basements. You could still drive up on your lawn and park. And it won't give the appearance to be a racetrack. Option two keeps the road about the way it is now. You know, save the debate about the 50-foot wide right away. I'm not sure, but that's probably a good idea to gain 50 foot right away. It doesn't mean that construction has to take place within the additional land area. But option two leaves the road basically the way it is, just clearing up the real problem at Fickett Street and Sawyer, which I think needs to be cleaned up, needs to be addressed. Whether or not you move it into the field and save the trees, or whether you cut the trees, I mean, the impact has got to be studied. But I would go for a 24-foot wide road, and I think it would be adequately sufficient to serve, where they'd be getting away with a 22-foot wide road, maybe 26, 24, 26. But I think that would be certainly wide enough, and I'd agree with that.
Michael would like to respond.
I would like to make a couple points in response to that. A month ago, the town council passed new subdivision regulations, which became effective yesterday, for a feeder road with shoulders, which this is, you know, we could call it an arterial, perhaps it is. Let's assume it's only a feeder road.
And this one's grandfathered.
It was 44 feet that you felt was an adequate standard. We're already down to 30 feet, which is, you know, 50% less, almost 50% less than 44 feet. I think we've already made significant compromises on modern standards. Second point I'd like to make is, even though there will be the Cape Cod curb, people can drive over and park on their lawns, they're generally going to, you know, try to park on the street, particularly during all those special events we constantly hear about, from the people getting together to play cards to everything else. And so, you know, those instances always occur. The other point I'd like to make is that the shoulder, in addition to being a bikeway, parking, all those things, jogging path, is also very important for drainage. And if you narrow it up to 24 feet, what you're going to have is cars that are driving through the area where the water is parked, moving along the curb. And when that ice is up, you know, particularly in this big flat section we have here, it's not going to move very fast. What you're going to be doing is having cars moving along the shoulder, right in the water and right in the ice, when it'd be a lot better off if that was off the regular travel way and was in fact in a shoulder. So I would strongly discourage you from narrowing it further below the standards that you adopted last month.
Ken, would you still like to comment? Ken, yes, sir, would you mind coming to the podium so people at home can hear you?
Ken will be proud of you with that necktie on.
My daughter made it. He mentioned that the drainage area is very bad, and I'm just wondering, I haven't heard anything mentioned about septic tanks and leach beds, which probably a lot of them are on the front lawn there. How many of those are you going to be draining into the brook? That's all I need to say.
Good. Thank you, Ken.
Can I respond to that?
Yes, Michael.
Yeah, some of the citizens who were at the public meeting we held on this did bring up that subject, and it is something that in the final design we're going to have to take a look at in the acquisition of rights of way. If people have their septic systems in a right of way, it's by taking away that property, it's very likely we will have to address their septic tank situation. It's a cost doing the project, and again, you know, the longer we delay the project, the more septic systems there'll be in there, and the greater problem I think we'll have.
Okay, we have been discussing this at length now this evening, and at our last monthly meeting, we spent a long time on it also. Is the council at this time ready to take any action on this Sawyer Road reconstruction? Does anybody have a motion to put forward? Do you want to table it till next month? I mean, what do you want to do?
I don't.
I think we're talked out on the subject.
I don't want to table it.
Okay.
And I think we should be able to come to a consensus some way or another as far as which option. The only reason I started off tonight is try to cut down a speedway, which I feel is going to be created as they come down off of Fickett Street, and some way we could get a stop sign. Number two, I'm not in favor of at all. And I think if we put a stop sign there on Fickett, that isn't going to send the people over to 77. I don't quite believe that. And I also feel that now is a time to get a right-of-way through there for a road. Now, whether you build it now or not, that's another thing. But I think you should be getting the land. It's just as I said to Penny, I hope you rolled over Wells Road. I know a house has been built within the last year, and if you want to get 8 or 10 feet off of that side of his road, of Wells Road, you will have his septic system coming down the edge of the road. So I know which side of the road you'll be on to get your 50 feet. And I think these things, if you're thinking ahead, these things should be done now, so when you want to do something, you have the land. I am in favor of option number three.
Three or two?
Three.
Are you making that in the form of a motion?
That's different than you said before.
I was against two. I'm definitely against two. That's this one right here.
Yeah.
I just wanted to figure out a way with the other options here that we could have a stop sign, so to stop the people from having a real racetrack down through there, and I just feel that's what it's going to be. If I may, I just thought of a question I might like to ask Bob Hunter. How much of the hill on Pickett Street will you take off? Will it be down to the level of that dip there, or are you going to fill some of the dip in right about at the Cape South Pullman line?
Well, I think it's kind of balanced out in there, but we're taking off some of the top, and you're going to be filling that low spot a little bit, but you won't have the sag.
No, but you'll still have the hill there for people to come directly down over and down.
Oh, yes, that's still, it's going to be, Pickett Street coming down will still be a steep grade of 8 to 9%. There's just no way you can avoid that without just taking out tremendous amounts of rock that would not be practical. So you're absolutely right, and no matter what you do with Pickett Street, you're going to have a steep downgrade or upgrade on that section. Right now it's 10% or a little bit over. I think that the when we get done, we're probably going to be about 9% will be what we'll end up with. So that is a steep grade.
Now, I may be confused, but I thought option three is the one that put the center line out where the hydrant is.
That's correct.
Okay, that's the one I'm in favor of.
So are you
and I'll make a motion that we approve option three.
Stop sign on that one?
I'll check.
That cuts the corner off, that's correct.
But it doesn't cut off all the trees.
That's right.
And it doesn't cut as far into the ledge on the Young's property.
That's right.
I would support that.
You
that
have a second.
Also. Yeah, we have a second. I think it is time that we do take some action if we're going to take any action at all on this road. I hope that we can get a consensus to go ahead. Is there any other comments, any further discussion? Okay,
I think it's great to put a stop sign there. I think you're going to create accidents if you put a stop sign there because of...
Well, we're not talking about putting a stop sign.
Coming down Pickett, that's what you're talking about. Coming down Pickett.
Oh. I just said when I brought it up... When I brought it up originally, I brought it up with the idea if there was some way we could do it. My motion doesn't have a stop sign in it. We're going to do option three, and I guess we can't have no stop sign. Maybe we can get a red light there. I don't know.
Wouldn't there be a stop sign?
I might comment on the stop sign again. That if you wanted stop signs there, I think you would basically have to put a stop sign both on Pickett Street as you come down and on Sawyer Street as you come up to the intersection. You couldn't let, if you let one flow free and the other one stopped under that configuration. If you stopped Pickett Street but let Sawyer Road run free, I think you would be really increasing the accident potential, and that would be a hazardous situation. Now, you could put a stop on Sawyer and a stop on Pickett, so they both have to stop. It's similar to the four-way stop sign concept where, to slow them down, everyone comes to a stop and eases out.
Put a three-way stop.
You could put a three-way stop. Or, I guess what I'm saying is, as a minimum, you'd have to have a two-way stop. You couldn't just stop one leg. You'd have to stop at least two of them. Now, whether you want to do that or not, I would think that might be something that would be looked at after it's in, and the police chief has a chance to monitor the traffic flow and see what problems there are there. And if you wanted to do that, then you could put the stop signs in. Obviously, that interferes with the free flow of traffic, but it could be done.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Any other questions, comments? Are we ready to vote? All those in favor of the motion for option three? All those opposed? Okay, the motion fails. Is there anyone else prepared to make a motion at this time?
I move that we take option two.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of option, yes?
The discussion. I'd like to ask Lester, who made the motion, if he would even reduce the width of that road to minimize the impact. I know that my manager has indicated that some of the council voted this new ordinance, but that basically is the new road. It's not reconstruction. We have a critical area here, part of our rural character. We may have some other roads coming up in the future that we may want to set a precedent here, trying to keep them as rural as possible, but as safe as possible also. And I think a reasonable compromise, whether it be 30 feet, 26, 28, or whatever, I would only ask if you intended.
Your idea isn't anything new, because we did it with the Hennepin Gold Road.
That's true.
So yes, I...
Yes, Nancy?
In response to that, I just feel very strongly, Doug, that it's really silly to put $800,000, $900,000, with the acquisition, over and then into a road and have it be obsolete in probably 8 or 10 years. I mean, I really think it's silly to reconstruct that road and know you're going to have to go back in a few years and widen.
Yes.
Okay. We have an obsolete road system on both ends of it already under your scenario. The newly reconstructed within the last, I don't know, 10 years, Sawyer Road to the south is that same width I was proposing. The Sawyer Road to the north is even less. So we have a section of superhighway with nowhere to go. What I'm saying is, in a delicate area, and we're trying to preserve the rural character of the town, make them consistent with each other. We may have an outdated road, but at least we'll have a thoroughly outdated, consistent road, rather than a big piece in the middle, which means we'll have to reconstruct both ends.
Bill?
I'd like to answer Councilor Tinsman's. Sawyer Road to the south has got width enough there that it could be expanded to match into this with some filling in and moving some ledges. There's plenty of room down through there. And if you come down by the brook just before you get to Wells Road, that is out, I think, to this width. And it does have the curb, and as you go by the houses there just before you get to Pam's and what have you. And also by your brother's driveway there. Just beyond that, you've got curb and what have you. That all could be matched right into this road within a few years, and I don't think it would cost any big sum of money. You haven't got the houses up close to it. The only closest thing there is a gun club.
Anyone else? All right, all those in favor of reconstructing Sawyer Road along the model of option two. All those in favor of that motion. All those opposed. That motion fails 2-4. Are there any other motions?
Let me try option four.
Could we have...
Sounds like a lottery.
No, we haven't had so much information on four. That doesn't take any land from Mr. Young, or not as much.
I think
moves the road over to the other side, doesn't take any of the trees. The intersection.
Okay, option four
would essentially, point out, not take any of Mr. Young's land. That would push the alignment over into the field area to some extent. It looks like you would probably take 1, 2, 3, 4, probably 5 of the that lower trees in there would have to be taken.
What about the house with the fence in front of it?
The house with the fence in front of it, the fence may have to be moved slightly. The edge of the pavement would probably be moved towards that house, maybe 7 or 8 feet at a driveway location. And the fence would be relocated maybe feet. What that does is puts a somewhat sharper angle in at this location. It does move off the other property. It minimizes the amount of ledge that you have. It does take, say, 5 or 6 trees. It takes more of the field area. I think from a geometric design point, a theorist in the highway profession wouldn't like it as well. But I think, as I pointed out, that any of these would be generally acceptable under the criteria that we're looking at for this road.
Michael wanted to make a comment.
Yeah, I realize there's only 3 votes tonight for option 3. I also realize Councilor Latore has more or less gone on record on supporting a project. Of course, he hasn't had the benefit of the discussion tonight. One reason we wanted to have something adopted tonight was to do the final design to get this in line for next year's construction season. If we don't make a decision soon, we will do one of 2 things. One is miss next year's construction season and get into a winter situation like we are on Hanford Cove Road at this time, or 2, delay or along with that perhaps to miss the prime bidding season. When you miss the prime bidding season, your costs are apt to go up anywhere on a project this size, maybe $50,000 to $100,000. I would hope that some of those that are in the minority, you know, as the council chairman indicated, you know, might consider some of those factors and recognize the overall need for a project and come to some sort of a consensus.
Yes, Lester.
Well, it seems to me that we may have to wait for budget time to get your $200,000 or so to start with anyway. That is if most of the council didn't pay for taking it out of surplus.
Yes, Michael?
Yeah, the funds for what we need at this point is about $85,000 for final design and for appraisal services and all that sort of thing. Those funds are currently available in account 310-4003, which is our local roads project, previously appropriated by the council.
Try for 3 again.
So, Madam Chairman,
yeah.
Is reconstructing the road basically the way it is out of the question? I mean, is this just a absolute no-go from an engineering standpoint?
I think it is from a cost standpoint. It's like throwing your money away.
Well, I guess I would have to basically support what Mr. McGovern said. I think that if you read most of the criteria for roadways of this nature, you'd look at 30 feet as being about the minimum width that you'd want to put in. And while narrowing from 30 to 26 would save a little money, obviously, because you're not putting in the same amount of paving. But again, the drainage is all the same, and a lot of work stays fairly constant, so you don't really save an awful lot on the thing. Obviously, we will design the width or what you decide as a policy to do, but I would strongly support Mr. McGovern, and I think from an engineering standpoint that we would have to basically go on record saying that 30 feet is about the minimum acceptable design standard that we really think you ought to be adopting for this road. I think also I might comment that my experience has been, and on this question of speed control or speedways, that is controlled, I think, more perhaps by the smoothness, the consistency of the pavement, and it rides well, as opposed to the width. You're going to be driving in a 12-foot lane no matter what, and if it's smooth and it's relatively straight, then I think that the speed differential between a 26-foot wide paving and a 30-foot wide paving really isn't going to be that much of a factor.
Taking 2 votes, none of which have passed.
unless somebody is interested or is considering changing their vote, maybe the appropriate thing is to table this until next meeting.
I would hate to do that, but I'm going to make that motion just to see if it goes. I would move that we table this until Frank is back here on the council, and perhaps that can be the legitimate majority vote. I mean, he may support option three, option two, or maybe come up with another option that we could consider. But perhaps that's going to be the legitimate tiebreaker then.
You shouldn't have to wait for a council person to come back on anything.
Well, it hasn't been seconded.
Right. Is there a second to Doug's motion to table this? We talk about tabling it to next month?
Until next meeting.
Is there a second?
Next month?
Next month.
Is there a second to that motion?
You know, you guys might handle it next month.
Yeah.
I mean, next meeting.
Okay, I don't hear a second.
Second. I don't understand why that wouldn't be a reasonable option.
Okay.
What's going on the schedule?
Remember, tabling motions. We can discuss the motion to table.
Okay. You don't have to discuss the elements of it, but you can discuss the motion to table. Sure. The reason for it?
Not debatable. I didn't think it was debatable.
Yeah, it isn't debatable. The discussion is allowed.
The motion is not debatable. Okay, all those in favor of the motion to table this item until next month? All those opposed? I think this is why there's always an odd number on an elected board. All right, does anybody have another motion?
I move option four.
Is there a second to that motion?
No.
No second. Okay, anyone else?
Anybody willing to change their mind as far as three goes?
We'll try it.
Change your mind.
Oh, you mean to two? And narrowing it down?
No, that's short-sighted.
That's very short-sighted. I couldn't
do that. Narrowness was not even discussed other than asking him to change. There was still 30 feet on option two.
Okay, let's either have a motion or let's do something to move on to the next item.
Can I make the same motion I did before that got defeated?
Yeah.
I move that we adopt option two.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Nobody's going to do anything, so I guess we got to table it to the next meeting.
All right. Bill, you want
to? I'll make a motion that we table it to the next meeting. I mean, to the January meeting.
Doug?
Second.
All those in favor?
If I need a motion, Bill, I'm going to ask you to do it.
What?
All right. That motion finally carries 5-1. At this point, we'll take a 5-minute break.
How much, could I ask the man, how much is this going to slow up the project for a month, do you think? Fair statement to ask for?
It may make it a lot less money.
I don't think a month.